The David Feldman radio program is made possible by listeners like you. You sad, pathetic humps.
Welcome to the broadcast. I'm David Feldman, davidfeldmanshow.com. Please follow me on Twitter and friend me on Facebook. And if you want to support the show, the best way is to go to davidfeldmanshow.com. You'll see the Amazon banner and click on it. Then do all your Amazon shopping via the David Feldman Show website. And we get a small percentage, and it keeps the lights on here, which is very important.
Right now they're flickering, so that's very important.
Yes. Well, we're coming to the end of 2015, and we have two very special guests. I'm very excited about one.
Thank you.
And that's not...
That's a very rude thing to say about Samantha, but I appreciate hearing that.
I'm going to leave.
Samantha Ruddy is going to be at the Creek in the Cave January 5th at 10 p.m. Mark Norman will be headlining, and you are a very, very funny young comedian.
Oh, thank you.
You really are.
I appreciate that.
We've worked together a couple of times. You have great jokes, your great stage presence, and how long have you been doing it?
3 years in February.
Well, you are fantastic.
Thank you.
You really are. You're fantastic.
David, take your hand off her knee. She's your guest.
Speaking of comedians who are fantastic, Leah McEnany, you know a couple, don't you?
Yeah, and I do. They're going to be on the show with me on January 10th.
Liam, how many comedy albums have you put out?
I did a comedy concert film, so I'm on that soundtrack album. Mm-hmm. And then I put out a solo album 2 years ago called Comedian. So this is going to be my second proper album.
And you are taping a new album at the Bell House. That is in Brooklyn.
That's in Brooklyn.
January 10th. Colin Jost and Dave Hill will be there opening for you.
That's correct.
So if you want to see Colin Jost from Saturday Night Live.
It's so sad because I have a lot of friends who've been like, well, yeah, I'll try to make it out. And then I say, oh, and Colin Jost will be on. They're like, oh, man, Colin Jost, I'll be there.
Mm-hmm.
And so, like, I'm not even the headliner on my own headlining gig.
And Dave Hill. And then, you know, you have your dessert and then eat your vegetables and watch Liam McEnany. It starts off.
I just want your money, folks. Come pay, see the guys you want to see, and get out.
No, you really are a great comic.
I know.
You really are.
And I'm a great comic.
We're going to look back at 2015. Samantha, 3 years. Where did you first do comedy?
So I started in Syracuse, New York.
Mm-hmm.
And I was in college. And then I did an internship in Denver. And I got like kind of serious about it there. Like I stopped just doing like a mic once every few weeks.
I'm sorry, go ahead.
You go ahead.
I was going to say Denver's supposed to be a really good comedy town. Like the Grolics are from there.
Yeah, it's phenomenal. Honestly, I probably would have moved there if New York City wasn't just so much closer to where I grew up.
Right. And what kind of internship were you doing?
I was actually in tech. So I was doing a web development internship and then kind of moonlighting doing comedy.
And go ahead.
No, please. It's your show.
Go ahead.
So what kind of comedy scene does Syracuse have?
It's very tiny. It's a small city. It's uh-huh. got 150,000 people. There's not a huge indie scene there. The upstate New York scene sort of a conglomerate of a bunch of cities. Like, it's kind of Buffalo, Albany, Syracuse, and Rochester all together.
Barry Crimmins, Bobcat Goldthwait, Tom Kenny, Paul Kozlowski, Dan right. Spencer. A lot of great comics have come from that area.
Yeah, I actually just watched God Bless America, Bobcat's movie, and was like shocked when I realized that it was I thought everything looked familiar, and then I realized I was literally a block from like where they were filming things.
Yeah. And Call Me Lucky, the new documentary about Barry Crimmins, is worth looking at, directed by Bobcat Goldthwait. We're looking back at 2015. All right, how was your year, Samantha? Was it a year of growth as a comedian?
I think so, yeah. I think it really was a time where it was my first full year in New York. So I kind of got more stage time than I ever have.
Mm-hmm.
And I think when you're doing like double-digit sets a week, it's pretty impossible to not grow.
Yeah.
Are you getting laid more now?
No.
Really?
Oh, yeah, like a little.
A little. What would you say like a percentage of getting laid more? If you had to put like a number on it.
Wow.
Honestly, like 10 out of 10. I don't know.
10 out of 10? 10
out of 10.
Is that, now, I'm laughing, but is that an appropriate question? Do you know Liam?
No, not at all.
I'm just curious. Like, because she's moving from a smaller like comedy scene to like a bigger comedy scene where she's meeting a lot of strange people, and you know, like you're out there and you're doing shows.
So
and
you think drunk. I'm like only sleeping with strange people, though?
Well, yeah, of course.
Well, yeah, we're all strange people, but
I'm curious, Liam McEnany,
right?
Because I'm old school,
right?
You don't really know Samantha, do you?
Very old school.
Yes.
In fact, some would say elderly school.
Plato's Symposium is how old my school is.
Because when I think of a true gentleman, the name that springs to mind is Mr. David Feldman.
Okay, but not knowing somebody and then right. asking them, are you getting laid?
I feel like this is a better, this is a very appropriate venue. Because like you wouldn't, I wouldn't ask her that. In a normal conversation.
But like inquiring minds want to know.
But I feel
get
like
it.
That's a very interesting... I think that that aspect of being a comedian is something people are more interested in than like, you know, like
are
how
you
getting
write a laid? Joke. Are you getting
laid?
Are
you getting laid, Liam?
You getting laid?
No, of course not.
When's the last time you got laid, Liam?
Last time I got fully laid was a year ago. Me and my ex-girlfriend.
What does fully laid mean?
Penis inside vagina.
Now, is this appropriate...
Why not?
Conversation for our year in review. By the way.
Yeah, right? Your year in review. That was not one of the questions.
That was not... okay, so...
It's been a year of growth for me because I gained about 50 pounds.
All right, this is not... we're looking back at 2015. This is not a question for Samantha Ruddy. What is?
Are you really shocked by that question?
What is your Twitter handle?
It's Samly Matters. S-A-M-L-Y Matters.
Uh-huh. And if people... don't live in New York City, but want to become familiar with your brilliant joke writing. Because I love comedians and comedians who can write jokes. That's just, I'm a sucker for that kind of stuff. And I was watching you at the Brit Pack and went, wow. So if people want to see a sample of your work, but they don't live in New York, what do they do?
If you just pop my name into YouTube, I have a few videos up there.
Good. Okay, and it's Ruddy.
Yes.
Okay. Any relation to Ruddy, the president of the broadcast network in the movie Network?
You know what? I get that a lot, and no.
You don't get that.
I don't get that a lot.
Okay. All right, so, Liam.
Yes.
Best sexual episode of the year 2015?
Well, I did get to watch... Do you feel like that's an appropriate question?
I'm going to ask you a question. What was the best sex you had this year?
Well, I just said I really haven't like gotten too laid this year. This has been a transitional year for me in terms of.
Did you
is
make
it a rebuilding?
Did you
year?
Make out with anybody?
It's a rebuilding. Yeah, I made out with a couple of women, and you know, it was all right.
That's what usually happens to me.
What's that?
Like I don't get laid a shit ton off of shows, but I will have girls like want to make out with me in a back alley after right. a show and then be like, I live in Bronx. And I'm like, okay, I'm not. Bye.
The Bronx?
Or wherever.
Jesus, where are you performing?
The Bronx. The Bronx.
So
I had a woman once. I met her at a bar and she told me she lived up in the South Bronx. Mm-hmm. And I took the train all the way up there. And then it turned out. I walked her to her apartment, and it turned out she hadn't wanted me to go up with her to the Bronx, and she like thought that I was gonna not follow her home, and she was actually very upset.
Mm-hmm.
Well,
I totally misread those signals.
You know, I've only known you.
So don't go to the Bronx. Don't not go to the Bronx.
Do you know that the Bronx? You know how it got its name?
No.
Do you know?
The Yankees. I don't know.
There was an actual family called the Bronx.
No way.
They were Dutch.
I feel like that was not an appropriate question to ask us, David, for the year in review episode.
I know.
You going barely on a tangent. Know
us. But sure, there was a Dutch family called the Bronx.
Uh-huh.
And we're going to visit the Bronx. And that's...
And they were actually, and I actually do know this story, they were the first family that sold crack in America.
Mm-hmm.
And so they settled the Bronx, and they founded this Dutch crack company that is still working to this day.
Yes. My father's from the Bronx, Simpson Street.
Oh.
Tough Bronx is okay. And Samantha, are you in love? Am I allowed to ask that?
Well, I think that's did way less appropriate than how many.
Did you find love this year?
I have been in love with the same person for 4 years.
Is it requited?
It is, but we're also like very open and new agey and terrible and all that stuff. So like we, you know, do stuff with other people too.
Do you live in the same city?
Mm-mm.
Okay.
And is love 100%? In other words, can one person love somebody more than the other person loves somebody? Or is love just 100%? Once you say, I love you, then you don't have to do anything or prove it.
Not at all.
I wonder about open relationships.
That's, well, are you in love?
Am I in love? I am not in love. I really wasn't kidding when I said, like, this has been a year.
I'm not talking about sex. I'm talking about you can be in love with somebody who's not in love with you.
I'm telling you, I actually just got over someone who ghosted me 10 years ago, and that's not a joke.
And when he says ghosted, he killed her.
Did you follow her home to the Bronx?
No, it was actually the girl that I had a crush on in junior high school.
Okay.
And then 10 years ago, we met as adults, and we dated for a month, and it was great. And then she completely ghosted me, as you kids say.
Yes, you can.
And it took me so long to get over her.
Okay, like, so being in love with somebody from you had a crush on her in junior high school,
and I never forgot about her.
Right.
And then I looked her up.
And you can't shake it, right?
You can't shake it. And I found her on Friendster. That's how long ago this was.
Oh man.
And you know,
did she have a crush on you?
Yeah, it turned out she had a crush on me in junior high school, and she would have like kissed me in junior high school if I had made the move.
Uh-huh.
So if you kids are listening, don't be fucking pussies.
All you children out there.
So that you were fulfilling like a masturbatory fantasy.
It wasn't like, honestly, I never jerked off to her. It was just like the kind of thing where she always had like a little home in my heart. Like the kind of person like you always go back to over
so
and over.
That's so sweet.
So a woman can have a home in your heart but not in your penis, right?
Well, no, my penis would have a home in her. I think that's how it works for most people, David. I don't know how big your pee hole is, but most guys can't fit a woman.
What would you be more interested in, the home in your heart or the home in your penis?
Well, actually, now I'm looking more for a relationship. I got laid a lot as a young comedian myself in my 20s. And I feel like that's probably why I asked you that question, because I am living vicariously through younger people
now.
You're
just like, oh, are people still having sex? Yep, we're still doing that.
I just want to know that it still happens for somebody. But no, I mean, honestly, like right now I'm looking to settle more. Like, I mean settle both, settle down and settle for the best I can get.
Right.
So in every sense of...
As settle for, in every sense of the word.
Can we talk about love with you? Or?
Oh, sure, yeah.
So... Are women, do you find women are difficult and getting more difficult?
Not really.
In relationships?
I mean, I don't have a whole lot of experience. I'm 23 years old. Like
You're 20. That's right. You are.
Yeah, I'm a baby.
Yeah.
Have you always known you were gay?
No, I didn't know until I was 18.
Okay.
I really, and in retrospect, I'm like, oh, it makes so much sense. But like, it hit me like a ton of bricks because I just had a girl be like, you're gay. Right. And I was like, oh, I'm gay. Like, I just had, like, someone just said it to me. And then it was like, it just clicked.
And what was harder, telling your parents that you were gay or a comedian?
Honest to God, comedian.
That's so funny because I had a woman tell me I was gay. And I was just like, no, it's just whiskey sometimes makes me do that.
And Liam never had to tell his parents he was a comedian because he really technically isn't one.
How dare you?
Your parents were accepting of all that stuff?
Yeah. I mean, they're both pretty conservative people, but they were like, just, you know, they just got it. Like, my dad just knew. Like, because mm-hmm. I guess when I was in ninth grade, I guess I broke up with the quarterback, and he was like, yeah, that's what I knew.
Yeah, because no,
normal
no straight girl would break up
whatever.
With the quarterback.
Yeah, no, I know.
You dated the junior high school quarterback?
Well, it was the high school because we were in ninth grade.
You were the freshman. Was he varsity?
No, he was JV because we were kiddos. But yeah, I dated him and we went to like a semi or something together and I just got bored. Like I was just like, I'd rather hang out with my friends.
Now, David, you have daughters.
Hang on for 1 second. So she dated the quarterback.
Uh-huh.
To the
Oh, well, David, you know, David, is as a Jew, is very interested in football.
David, he's always looking to get,
he's always looking to get the quarterback.
Thank you. Okay. That's the second time you've done that joke on the show.
And only one time you've had to force me. No, but you have daughters. What if one of them said, like, you know, I prefer munching rug? Would you be upset?
Jesus.
I would be if that's how she chose to break the news to me. Be like, listen, I'm a lesbian, but you're disgusting.
I think... father, I would be grateful if one of my daughters was a lesbian. That way, my wife would have to put up with the mommy issues instead of the daddy issues that I have to deal with. Are there mommy and dad? I mean, do you have? I'm kind of curious because I may or may not have a couple of daughters who may or may not be estranged or not, whatever. Okay. But I don't want to delve into my private life that has completely fallen apart in 2015. But let's just, for the purposes of this show, I may or may not have. When you're dealing with women, mm-hmm. and you're a, do you have to deal with their daddy issues or their mommy issues in a relationship? Is that a stupid question?
I don't think it's a stupid question.
Is that a rude question?
No. I don't think it's a dumb or a rude question.
And you
but
talk
I
about this stuff a little bit on stage.
A little
right?
bit, yeah.
Am I making you uncomfortable?
No. Okay, no, then let's always move uncomfortable. On.
you know, by the way, a question can be dumb but not rude. Just doesn't have to be either.
No, I'm not uncomfortable at all.
If it's not making you uncomfortable, then
no, let's
move
go.
On. No, but I'm kind of curious. You asked me.
Right.
I like have a great mom who I love and is super sweet to me and stuff, but like judging by who I'm attracted to and who I date, I probably have mommy issues. Like, and it might be because my mom's so great.
Mm-hmm.
And like we're Italian, so she's very like, she still tries to
oh,
run
you're
my
Italian.
Life. Oh, yeah.
Ugh.
Awful.
Oh, it's much easier to deal with the fact that you're gay.
I know. It's like I came out to my parents as Italian when I was 18, and they were like, yeah, we know. Forget about it.
We saw whatever. You bring home the spaghetti and meatballs. We have an idea.
Yeah, we've known ever since you ate spaghetti.
Well, I would say, and this is just a sweeping...
Mom, I like to munch rigatoni.
Oh, God.
Wow, that was so bad. I should have said
well,
that.
Well, then why isn't
all right,
Samantha
I'm out.
Laughing?
Bye, guys.
I should have said that. That's pretty good.
I don't think anyone's going to turn that into a cartoon.
So, I would say most women have problems with their fathers, and they project those problems onto their husband or boyfriend. And that they keep reliving the same problems with their father with a series of relationships with men.
You just like opened up a floodgate for me.
Welcome to the 2015 in review.
David Feldman, you just ruined my life.
That is just conjecture. That is me pushing away the female. And I would say that men, heterosexual men, have issues with their mother, and then all their relationships with women are projected onto these women. And hopefully, you know, the Buddha talks about reincarnation. You keep reliving the same mistakes uh-huh. until you stop, and then you've learned it, and then you're no longer of this. I'm getting a note to shut up. Okay.
It's true.
I'm going to shut up.
It's true. I do keep saying yes to being on the David Feldman show.
Okay. I opened up a floodgate. I'm going to stop talking.
Well, then this is going to be a horrible podcast.
It's going to be awful. No, David,
does that happen in your relationships?
Like, the more I'm thinking about it, the more, like, I'm thinking about how, like, my mom's always been super overbearing and nurturing, and, like, I was so dependent on her as a kid and as a teenager. Like, not maybe because, like, and I think in some ways I thought it was because I'm an idiot and, like, mm-hmm. I just needed that. But mm-hmm. now I'm like, oh, maybe I feel like that because my mom never let me do anything.
Right.
Like, she was the kind of, like, I wasn't allowed to touch the stove till I was, like, 14. Like, mm-hmm. that kind of shit. And now I tend to date, like, really mothering, nurturing women who, like, baby me when I'm sick and, like, oh. and are older.
How old's your current girlfriend?
30.
Okay. Pretty hot. you know, it's funny. When I was around your age... I was not dating anyone because I was not dating. And my mom gave me the talk where she said, you know, if you're gay, your father and I will love you and support you no matter what.
Oh,
and
good
I
was, for her.
And I had to be like, no, mom, I'm not gay. I'm just not attractive to women. It's not my choice.
They really thought you were gay?
My mom really thought I was gay because I wasn't bringing girlfriends home. And, you know, like, she wasn't hearing any dating stories because there weren't any dating stories.
All right. Samantha Ruddy, what was the best comedy set you saw in 2015?
That I saw.
David Feldman.
David Feldman at BritPak was, it just really blew me away.
All right, good answer. No. What was the best set you saw? I think watching Barry Crimmins at The Creek in the Cave.
Well, that's the most recent set you've seen. Is that also like the best, or is that just the one you can remember?
This year was watching Barry Crimmins. That, I would say, was the best I've seen. I didn't see a lot of stand-up, but that's the best I've seen.
You haven't seen me do stand-up this year?
Is that what you're calling it?
No, it's actually stand-down comedy, because it takes an army to stop me.
What have you seen this year that blew you away? It's hard, right?
It's hard when you're on the spot. But I think I've always been a really big fan of joke writers. Mm-hmm. Like they're like people who, and I'm not meaning to say that comedians who are like excellent performers are joke writers. But I've always been more appreciative of like the Mark Norman, Sam Morril style of comedy where they could be literally standing still and it wouldn't matter at all. But this year I saw Sean Patton for the first time. And I don't know if you guys know. I think I saw him at.
I know Sean.
Yeah, I saw him at like Bar Matchless, and he was just a monster. Like he just went nuts on stage, and the energy was so high, and like it was just amazing. Like it was just the coolest thing. It was like such a cool like New York kind of moment.
I was on my way to San Francisco, and I put on Facebook, "Hey, who's in San Francisco?" And my buddy Tony Kameen responded, "I am opening for Patton Oswalt, who's recording his special at the Fillmore, and you're welcome to be my guest." And so I went to see Patton tape his next special at the Fillmore, and it's like the best hour I've ever seen Patton Oswalt do live anyway. And it was amazing. It was like really like, it's just one of those things where you walk out of the theater and you're like, all right, I'm gonna keep working. I gotta keep working on this set,
right?
You know. And then I would say second best is I was looking at my old YouTube videos and I saw one of me performing in Glasgow. It's pretty good. You guys should check it out.
Okay.
Just go to heyitsliam.com. You'll find all my videos.
The best podcast of the year that I heard was, and it wasn't taped this year though. I thought Maron's interview with Lorne Michaels was pretty phenomenal. But my favorite podcast was Marc Maron talking to Louis C.K. Have you heard that?
Yeah, it was amazing.
That was amazing. That must have been a couple of years ago, right?
I don't know.
Yeah, that was a few years ago.
Yeah, I think it was like, but not a long time. Like, I want to say that was like early 2014 or something.
I'll mention also Gilbert with Chevy Chase this year blew me away because I had no idea how brilliant Chevy Chase was.
I liked Gilbert with Chevy Chase. In terms of the Gilbert Gottfried podcast, I actually preferred this interview he did with a completely unknown guy who just writes books about old showbiz.
Oh, Cliff Nesteroff.
Not Cliff Nesteroff. Another guy. Again, I don't even know his name, but like, you know who I'm talking about, Alex? Like, he's a dude who like just was friends with these crazy Z-list Hollywood, old Hollywood comedy celebrities like Shemp, I think. Like, whoever's the last stooge to die, like, the last munchkin to die from The Wizard of Oz. I mean, all these, like, crazy stories about all these, like, you know, it was like the movie Ed Wood, when Ed Wood befriends Bela Lugosi at the end of his life. That's the kind of stories this guy had about these weird, like, Hollywood fringe characters who just kind of were a little bit famous. You don't know? Okay. But I feel like if you're going to listen to Gilbert podcast, I feel like I actually prefer the ones with the more obscure people because he really, I mean, that's also like, I would listen, but like this guy's talking about this munchkin he knew and he's like, well, you know, these little people really have these don't generally have long, happy lives. And Gilbert goes,
oh, gosh.
Yeah. Have you heard Gilbert's podcast?
I have not.
Gilbert Gottfried's podcast. There are two things that I have to listen to. It's Gilbert's podcast and Rachel Maddow's television show, which I listen to as a podcast. I just don't feel any... It's for me, it's effortless to listen to both of those. It's just pure joy. The interview that he did with Chevy Chase was phenomenal. And the interview that Marc Maron did with Louis C.K., which I guess is 2 or 3 years old, we were driving back from Boston listening to that. And it was just one of those things where you go, oh, I see why podcasts are so popular.
Yeah, you literally got to listen to a friendship rekindle. It was amazing. Yeah.
And in fact, what Maron's done now is he's put basically all the old WTFs on YouTube because people were just uploading it anyway. So if you're looking for all these old WTFs, like the Louis one or the Robin Williams one, which is, I think him at his best personally, or the Mencia ones, like they're all on YouTube now.
Mm-hmm.
You can listen to the one I was on if you really. I prefer people don't, but it's out there now. That's how I found out, was because suddenly my Google alert pinged, and there I was on YouTube.
Mm.
Best Subway story. I'm going to tell you my best Subway story.
Uh-huh.
I met Jared.
Oh, God.
He said, David Feldman, you are a 6. And you were like, well, that's not very nice. And he's like, no, I mean, you know, 6 out of 6 years old.
By the way, I think I wrote the best Jared.
Samantha wasn't comfortable with
I
that
wrote
joke.
The best Jared joke.
I was totally fine with it. Lay your Jared book. Lay it on me.
Now, everybody has written a joke about Jared Fogle, right?
Yeah,
I haven't. But you know.
I don't know if I tweeted something. I can't remember.
That's for lesser comics, but go ahead.
And I was doing John Fugelsang's show. John Fugelsang's show.
Oh, from They Might Be Giants?
No, that's John. That's the other John. No, he's talking about John Fugelsang, the comedian.
Oh, I'm an idiot.
He has a show on Sirius XM with Frank Conniff. And this just came to me.
Worst name drop ever. Total name drop, Phil, David.
I'm so sorry.
And they were joking about Jared, and this just came to me.
You know my good friend John Fugelsang?
It was a bolt.
I was on his show.
You know how, like,
she's not a cross-country trucker. She doesn't listen to Sirius XM, David.
This was
a bolt of lightning from Zeus, this joke. It just came to me.
I can't
in
wait.
In the middle of the show. It's Jared, the Subway guy, is a horrible human being because not only did he molest these kids, but afterwards he would charge them $1 for the avocado.
Oh.
My mother loves that joke.
I would have gone 50 cents for double meat, but that's me.
He charged them an extra $1 for the avocado. That's I stand by that joke. And you know when I do that on stage, Alex, can you hear me? Or
you should stand behind that joke so no one can hear you say it.
Oh, Alex is waking up. When I do that joke on stage, it doesn't get a big laugh.
Right.
But there's usually one person who just loses it.
And you know what? If you can make just one person in an audience laugh, you are a failure as a comic. You should get out of the business.
Best Subway story. Do you ride the subways?
Every day.
Okay. I have a Subway story. Should I go first or do you want to go first?
You can
What's
go
the
first.
Most disgusting thing?
Wasn't disgusting, but something just shocking that I saw on the subway. I was waiting at Barclays for a train. And when it pulled up, the conductor was out cold. She was just dead asleep. You know what the best thing is? I still got on it because I was that late to work.
Oh, dude, when I was a kid in old New York, I was taking the one train to Lincoln Center, and I was in the last car where the conductor was,
mm-hmm.
and his door was open, but it was, like, situated so you couldn't see into the, because it was, like, open, and then it was face, and you could just hear him basically fucking a woman, and... And so, like, they were giggling, and you could hear the noise. And I was, like, young enough, I didn't understand it was fucking. I just knew that they were fooling around. And
every time, canoodling about.
Every time they pulled into a station, he had to pause and announce the station. And sometimes you could hear her giggling over the loudspeaker.
Wow.
And sometimes, like, I think one time she made the announcement. And that was the 80s.
When I first saw Colin Quinn, this was before he was famous, he used to do a bit about how New Yorkers on the subway would go, he's just faking it. He doesn't need money. And be a guy with, it gets to the point where it's a guy with no arms and legs. He's just a head and a torso. He's faking it. He doesn't need any money. Do you know this bit? Right? Yeah. It was one of Colin Quinn's first bits. So I've seen this. And I apologize because I don't mean to laugh at somebody's misfortune. But when you get on the subway, there's always somebody says, excuse me, ladies and gentlemen. Mm-hmm. I'm sorry for this interruption, but I am a homeless World War I veteran who is like, just for 25 cents, everybody looks the other way.
Also, I'm a ghost,
right?
Because World War I.
Right. So I always think of Colin's bit. Mm-hmm. Three times I've seen this lady. She, God's going to punish me. She's got a grapefruit-sized tumor growing out of her head.
Mm-hmm. What part of her head?
The right side of her head. And I've three times on the shuttle that goes from Times Square to Grand Central Station.
Right.
And everybody's looking down, trying to ignore it. It's not funny.
You're not supposed to. The problem is,
I'm sorry.
You're not supposed to stare because she's got a thing.
Have you
her
seen
head.
This woman?
No, but I've seen people like that on the streets.
Right.
You're not supposed to stare because, like, it's rude to stare at someone
you're getting
with an affliction.
Like mixed social messages.
But at the same time, she's demanding your attention. And I feel like a buck would be so much money to be able to just openly stare at her as she walks down the subway. Like if there was someone who was shocking looking like that and I could pay them a buck to be able to just fucking stare at their affliction, I would do it. That's like a bargain.
Any subway, Union Square, 14th Street subway. I was transferring, and the Demarest High School marching band was playing downstairs in the subway, echoing off the tile. And I started. They were playing John Philip Sousa music during rush hour, and we all started marching. And you realized it was performance art because we all were marching.
Purposely or
yeah, they were telling us that we're just soldiers of commerce. It was absolutely brilliant to have a marching band, and I started, I'm marching to get the, what am I getting, the 7?
Did you realize that you were, like, was it subconscious?
Yeah, everybody started marching.
But, like, subconsciously?
No,
like,
we all recognized that we were being told that we were.
To do it. And you were corporate cogs.
Yeah.
And did it hurt? When you got your fucking mind blown, man.
When you found out that you're just a
you're
peg
just a
in the
fucking
system.
Soldier of commerce, man. Holy shit.
Uh-oh. Somebody just read a book.
Did they slam down a mic at the end of that?
Best ISIS recruiting video.
Oh, Jesus Christ.
I would have to say that... That would have to be Sex in the City, too.
You're absolutely right.
100%
that's
right.
Perfect.
Yeah, I think that's...
that is absolutely Sex in the City, too.
The one where they go to Abu Dhabi.
Oh,
uh-huh.
Shop,
we
know.
Girl.
Uh-huh.
I would say Donald Trump's latest speech. No. Best concert of 2015?
That I went to see Sleater-Kinney, and it was awesome.
You are a lesbian. Holy shit.
Oh, it was delightful.
Who's Sleater-Kinney?
Carrie Brownstein from Portlandia.
Yeah.
It's her band.
Ah.
They're a very seminal feminist quasi-lesbian rock band that's been around for 30 years.
They're the best.
And it's a lesbian band.
No. They're queer.
They just happen to be lesbians.
Well, you said seminal.
But I don't think any of them are actually lesbians.
I mean, they're covered in semen by the time.
Seminal. Oh, God.
What is the best Amy Schumer's The Greatest Comic Ever article that you read this year?
Wait, you're not going to...
Whatever by Salon. I don't know.
Wait, what was the best concert you saw, David?
I don't know if I went to a rock concert this year.
Well, I'm going to say by the fact that you called it a rock concert, you probably didn't.
Yeah. Well, he's more into hip-hop. You know,
yeah, David
trance.
Goes to...
Yeah, EDM.
I just popping Molly all day.
Jeff Ross, the comedian... took me to a private party that he did. Uh-huh. Max Weinberg,
awesome.
Southside Johnny, and Rage Against the Machine. What's his name?
You're talking about Tom Morello?
Yes. Yes.
I went...
But I didn't go... I don't go to I don't have time to go to concerts.
Well, I'm going to tell you the best concert I've been to. I went to see Neil Young at the Jones Beach Amphitheater, which if you get a chance to go see a concert, I'd never been out there. It's beautiful. It's like open air. It was a beautiful evening. The breeze was blowing. My friend Catherine Popper is in a band.
That's our orchestra.
That's your orchestra. She's in a band with Nora Jones called Puss in Boots, like a country music band. Because they're ladies.
It's called Starbucks Duets.
Ravi Shankar's daughter.
So they opened for Neil. And then Neil Young did like a 3+ hour concert. And it was too much. You know what? When the main part of the show is over, I was like, I kind of hope he doesn't do an encore. Because he has rocked me so hard. Like, I would be very happy to leave right now. And then he came out and did like a 20-minute encore that was amazing also. Because it's Neil fucking Young, you know?
Now, we did a live show at QED.
We did.
You're the band leader.
I'm the band leader.
And what is our band? The Andy Kindler calls Frank Conniff the funniest man in the world orchestra.
Right.
And it consists of whom?
I don't play an instrument, so I'm the band leader. And then Catherine Popper, who plays the bass. And that's it.
And she's going to... when
so
we
just
do
the bass?
Yeah. And it's like it's a gig that's way below her pay grade.
Mm-hmm.
Luckily, and this is cool... luckily, David couldn't even be bothered to remember her name from one minute to the next.
Well, that was our first live show. That was a there were a lot of distractions.
It was,
I can barely remember my first name.
It was kind of off putting at the very end when you still didn't know her name.
I'm bad with names and faces.
Mm-hmm.
Biggest regrets of 2015.
We're here.
Uh-oh.
We're doing it.
I actually, just as you mentioned, bad with names and faces. I guess I don't really regret it. It didn't ruin my life or anything. It was kind of embarrassing. I was barking
Explain to the people what barking is, because they don't know.
So barking is this soul-crushing activity where you stand outside of a comedy club and yell, free comedy show, or, you know, tickets to a comedy show. You got comics from Broadway.
Who are you barking for?
I was barking for Greenwich.
Okay.
And it was a good experience. Like, overall, like, they paid me well. It was cool. But I was just, like, on autopilot.
Right.
And I tried to sell tickets to Greenwich Comedy Club to Dave Attell.
Oh.
And I was just like, oh. I don't know. He was wearing, like, a weird hat, and I just didn't click for a minute. And he was like, you know what? I think I'm all right. and I was like, oh, I'm an idiot. You're Dave Attell. And he was like, yeah, I'm Dave Attell.
At least he was nice about it.
He was so unnecessarily nice.
Yeah, I mean, he respects you. The comedy barkers are the people I respect the most.
Right.
Because you're working hard and you're bringing an audience.
And David aspires to someday be
a comedy
at that
barker.
Level. All right, you asked me to give you shit, and I feel like I sound like an asshole to the audience listening. So I want to explain, David asked me to bust his balls that way before the show started.
Yes, I did. And so go ahead.
I just did. I just did. But I feel like I sound unnecessarily mean.
I like getting my balls busted.
I don't think you do.
From you?
I don't think you like it.
Biggest regrets of 2015?
We're here. You know what? Actually, 2015 has been the opposite of that. I had a very bad end of 2014, and I kind of just decided this was going to be a better year, and it has so far. I really honestly can't think of any mistakes I've made. It's been a very good year for me.
My biggest regret of 2015 is I do a joke that Moody gave me. He fixed a joke of mine. I say I have no sense of humor about 9/11 because my first wife was in the South Tower that day, and she survived.
Oh.
And you made it home. That's fantastic, honey. That's right. So I've been doing that all year. And a woman walked up to me after the show,
mm-hmm.
and she said, I have a bone to pick.
Uh-oh.
And you're like, yeah. Give me 15 minutes, sweetheart. I have to take a blue pill for that.
And she goes, I am a survivor of 9/11.
Right.
And my biggest regret was just saying, I'm so sorry, instead of saying, I'm so sorry you survived. when I looked at her, I apologized for my joke, which you should never do.
Right.
And I said, I'm so sorry. And then I was about to say that you survived, but I didn't have the balls to do it.
That's probably good you didn't do it.
But the way David said it was, me so sorry. Oh, did I hurt your feelings?
By the way, what was the celebrations when the towers came down?
Were there?
Weren't there?
Well, I mean, I think Cheney was celebrating, right? Rumsfeld was celebrating.
Oh, great. Thanks. We're all on a list now, Liam.
Trump was celebrating. I mean, he's in the construction business. He's got to say, wow, I can. There's a lot of work coming my way.
You know who was celebrating? That dude Silverstein, who owned the property that the Trade Center was on. Because he got so much insurance. He got like $1 billion in insurance money. He probably got way more than he got for rent.
Were you here for 9/11?
Was I here? I was on one of the, no.
That's what I wish I had said. My brother died on 9/11. Muhammad Atta, do you know?
I was the only one who fucking remembered to bring his parachute. All those other guys, before he went to bed, I was like, do not forget to bring your parachutes tomorrow.
Were you here for 9/11?
Yeah, I was living in Queens. It was one of those things, like, I used to have my my alarm set to classic rock radio to wake up to, because I was so annoying. I would just wake up, get up, and turn it off. And it turned on, and I woke up, and this guy's just saying, you know, this is the only song I can think of that's appropriate to play right now. And it was Stairway to Heaven, which is a very long song.
So
I'm, like, sitting there waiting for Stairway to end so I can find. Eventually, I turned it over to the Stern Show, where they were talking about what was going on, and then I called my mom just to double check that I wasn't, like, fucking.
But you did listen to Stairway to Heaven.
I listened to it for about 2.5 minutes before I realized that I was not getting the information I wanted.
They're like, hold on, in this guitar solo, I know they're going to give us some info.
It would have been great if the DJ, like, talked over. Over the guitar solo.
Well, I mean, Stairway to Heaven, okay.
Yeah. But it was the only song that I, you know, like, maybe just continue to give us the news and not go.
not play Stairway to Heaven.
You were a baby, right?
I was close to, yeah. I was in fourth grade.
And did they have class that day?
We evacuated after a while, but right. For a little bit, we just sat, like, in our classroom and watched the TV.
Right. And then they were taken up to the roof to celebrate.
I went to Catholic school, buddy. There was none of that malarkey going on. It was pure, pure sadness and shame like every other day at Catholic school.
Who's the coolest person you met this year, Samantha?
The coolest person I met.
I want to say Alex Brazell, because that would be hilarious, but I think we all know that's not true.
He's our producer.
He's a producer.
And we're doing...
Hi, Alex.
He doesn't have his phones on. That's how on top of this he is right now. He doesn't even have his cans on right now.
Alex had a great year.
Alex had a great...
we're making fun of Alex. Alex, are you paying attention?
Yeah.
Hi. Okay.
When you say who's the coolest person you met, like...
Like in what sense?
Like, you mean like the most famous person?
Who's the most famous person you met this year?
Who's the most famous person I met this year? Well, the thing is, I'm kind of famous myself, so I feel like Samantha should say me.
Yeah. It was Liam, actually.
I'm trying to think who the most famous person I met this year is. I don't know.
I think probably the most famous person I met was... I think I like walked by Chris Rock. Actually, that doesn't count.
Did you bark him in?
I tried.
She told Chris Rock if he brought 10 people, he could do 5 minutes.
Yeah, I was like...
Who's the most famous person you've met in your life?
Most famous person I met in my entire life? That is a very good question. I don't know. You know who the coolest person I met? And this is one I can remember most recently. Was I'd never really met Todd Glass before.
Mm-hmm.
And I just met him. And this was like a fun evening. You know, Jim Gaffigan just did Madison Square Garden.
Yes.
And I guess Todd opened for him. So I went to the after party. And Todd, like, I ended up hanging out with Todd Glass for 45 minutes. And he is, like, a really super cool, really fun, really funny. But not like that, like, forcing himself to be on all the time. Like,
yeah.
Just like the way his mind works, he can't help saying funny things. And so what happened was we were talking about he knows who the next Colonel Sanders, like the next person who's going to be Colonel Sanders. But he wouldn't tell me. He was sworn to secrecy, like after Norm MacDonald. And we were talking and, you know, I think it's okay if I said, but we were like, he was like, do you think Sarah Silverman would take that gig? And I was like, she would take it in a heartbeat. That's awesome money. So
that'd be pretty funny. I bet it's Sarah.
It would be great. No, so he texted her and said, like, would you take this gig if they offered it to you? And she's like, yeah, of course. You know, like, it would be a couple of conditions. But, yeah, so like, that was a very, very cool, like, evening. As someone like me who, like, even though I do meet famous people, I'm always fucking starstruck by the weirdest people. And that was a very, like, I am still in comedy moment, you know?
The most star, like, the only, like, one of the only people I met this year that, like, I was, like, starstruck by was I met Eugene Merman, and I was, like, just an idiot.
I wasn't starstruck by Todd Glass. I was able to talk to him.
Well, yeah.
But, yeah, no, I know what you mean. Like, yeah. Where'd you meet, like, Eugene?
Just someone whose work you enjoy. I was just hanging out in front of my apartment, and he walked by.
Okay. And you say hello to him?
Yeah.
And what'd he say?
Hey, how are you? And I basically just told him I love Bob's Burgers, and uh-huh. We, like, talked for a minute, and then he took off.
And then he did a 15-minute PowerPoint presentation?
Yes.
I guess the most impressive person I met this year was the great Regurgitator.
I did a show. A friend of mine wrote a book about Devo's Freedom of Choice album, and I did this really fun release party show for it. And I did this bit that I'd never done before, I never did again. Like, I just wrote a bit specifically for this show that was, like, about stand-up comedy, like, done in the Devo style. And just very randomly, Mike Myers was in the audience. And, like, I didn't find out until after the show was over. And I didn't talk to him because he just doesn't seem like the kind of guy who wants to be approached by strangers so much. But the fact that he was there and the fact that, like, you know, like, I did really well in front of him, like, really made me happy. Like, that's the kind of thing, like, you know, more than meeting someone famous, like, when I can do well in front of someone whose work I really admire, that is, like, a highlight. You know, any time like that is a highlight in comedy for me. I think, you know, like, there's a couple of people I've performed with where I've done well and I've been like, all right, this is, you know, like, that's...
Best book you read?
I just read Amy Poehler's Yes, Please about a couple weeks ago when I was on a plane. I really enjoyed it.
I just saw Sisters last night.
Oh, how was it?
Hysterical.
Yeah.
You know what's great about that is all the comedy roles in that movie go to really talented women. Like, they're not overpowered by guys. Uh-huh. Although it's Rachel Dratch is hysterical. And
Rachel Dratch is always hysterical.
So underrated.
So, like, yeah. Just Maya Rudolph and the two of them, Amy Poehler and Tina Fey. It's stupid. It's a really stupid movie, but it's unapologetically stupid. It's really well done. Yeah. Sisters.
That's great.
Yeah.
Sisters. See it in theaters now.
I saw Hateful Eight.
Oh, I saw Star Wars.
I saw Star Wars as well.
Hateful Eight, I fell asleep.
Really?
Did you?
Yeah. Yeah,
I had a lot of problems with it, but boring wasn't one of them. I just thought it was bad. I thought it was a bad movie. I thought it was actually, I don't say this too much, I thought it was a genuinely misogynistic movie. I really thought that.
There was a lot of violence towards
one woman.
Yeah,
and it turned out she totally deserved it.
Uh huh.
like the whole point of the movie was these guys are physically beating up a woman for 3 hours, and she fucking
Jennifer
deserved
Jason
it.
Lee.
Yeah,
she's great in it.
Well,
how would you know?
Yeah,
about
seriously,
hitting a woman.
You passed out.
Oh, that's true. Well,
right. She was great at sitting quietly and getting punched in the face.
She's going to win an Oscar, best supporting actress.
She's going to win an Oscar for sitting quietly. But meanwhile, Tina Turner hasn't won an award in years.
Mm-hmm.
And that was her bread and butter for a long time.
What was your favorite movie of the year? Star Wars?
I really did enjoy Star Wars. I'm a real big sucker for big budget action film. Mm-hmm. They're just fun. I don't like watching them at home. Like, I like to watch them once in the theaters and, like, be happy about it. Like, I love Jurassic World, too.
I haven't seen Jurassic World.
It's really fun.
I don't go to see too many. I'm actually me. You know what I really liked, and I was glad I saw it in the theater, was Cesario. The movie about the Mexican drug trade and mm-hmm. about a young lady soldier who's kind of brought across the border.
Was that the Emily Blunt movie?
I don't know. I just know that it was scary as shit.
Oh.
It was extremely scary. It was like one of the scariest movies I've seen in a long time.
Oh, I also loved It Follows this year. That was like a really scary
What was that?
Movie. It was a horror movie that came out earlier this year. It was a good one.
What was it about?
It's way too long for me to just summarize here. I'll do it poorly.
You know what I was underwhelmed by? The Martian.
Did not mm-hmm. see it.
I call that the overrated Martian.
I agree.
I think that's a popular opinion, though, that the Martian is overrated.
No, I heard really? A lot of good things about it. Got a lot of great reviews. It's like a short list for an Oscar movie. But I was just like, and I saw it in 3D, which was also disappointing. Because the 3D effect, I wish I'd seen Inside Out instead of The Martian.
Yeah, that's what I heard Inside Out was great.
I heard it was amazing.
Have you seen A Very Merry Christmas? A Very Murray Christmas?
No.
Oh, no, that's on my list, though.
How was it?
Well,
did you write for that?
No.
Oh.
I don't think anybody did. Best book I've read this year? The Godfather.
Oh, you read... How long is it?
I don't know. It's about 400 pages.
Way shorter than I would expect.
The Godfather, by the way, the book, way more about vaginal reconstruction yes. surgery than you would expect.
Yes.
That's kind of a genuinely a running theme in the movie, in the book.
Yeah.
That they cut for the movie.
Yeah. Yeah. So you've read the book?
I've read the book.
I was shocked.
I found
the greatest continuity error in The Godfather.
What's that?
It's a great continuity error. I've been watching The Godfather over and over again. I've decided to become the world's foremost expert on The Godfather.
Right.
And I watch Godfather 1 and 2 on my tablet, and you can just spot every continuity error. Not that there are a lot, but there's one continuity error that I spotted that's minor. When Michael is arriving in Vegas
uh-huh.
to meet with Mo Green and Fredo's in the front seat, when he's pulling up to the casino, forget the 70s era guys with the beards that you see in the window. Everybody knows about that. What you don't know is it's not Fredo in the car.
Who is it?
It's just a double.
Like a stand-in?
Yeah, but the great continuity error that I discovered is Enzo the Baker. At the beginning of the movie, he comes and asks the Godfather for a favor.
Uh-huh.
And then later when the Godfather is shot and Michael needs him to stand guard.
Right.
And it's Enzo the Baker again. Completely different actor.
Really?
Oh,
yep.
Wow.
I didn't notice that.
Ladies and gentlemen, I found the ultimate continuity error in The Godfather.
Right.
There were two Enzo the Bakers. And I've Googled it. Nobody knows about it.
Right.
I think that you should start a podcast just about that.
Well,
start taking notice.
Everybody, you all own The Godfather. Watch the beginning. See who plays Enzo the Baker. He wants his daughter's fiance to be green carded into America.
No, that's not it, right? No, I'm sorry.
You're thinking of Amerigo. The funeral director. I'm talking about Enzo the Baker. And then when The Godfather is shot and Michael arrives and there's nobody protecting
right.
him in the hospital.
Right, okay.
Enzo the Baker's there with the flowers and he stands outside to guard him. Two different actors.
Marlon Brando is so good in that movie.
Okay.
Well, more people need to be talking about Becky from Roseanne being replaced. It's not enough of that on the internet.
Yeah, there were two Darrens on Bewitched also. Did you know that?
Yes.
Dick
Sargent was my nickname at the bathhouses in San Francisco.
And Dick York is what they're calling him now that you're back on the East Coast.
Dick York. Dick York.
Because it's New York.
That used to be the original
name. Explain that.
Dick York was the original name of Greenwich Village. A lot of people don't know this. Well, this has been great. Goodbye, 2015. I will not miss you, 2015. Not
you didn't like 2015?
Not at all. Not at all.
I
quit 2015 in January.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
Well, I don't know. It's been fun watching politics, national politics. That's been a delight seeing who's up for president. You know, your man Hillary seems to be in a little bit of trouble right now. Dave is a big Hillary supporter.
I am.
He's a big Hillary supporter, even though she's starting to look a little Nixonian. Starting to look a little Nixonian right there.
As we wrap up 2015...
He's not taking the bait.
Let me just say that this is a very sick and diseased country, and we don't have morals. We no longer know right from wrong. We are frightened ignoramuses. If you're having depression or anxiety, remember that you're breathing in toxic vibrations from a very sick and vile country. We have really, and you see it with Trump, and you see it in our politics, you see it with our news. It's not your fault. It's not seasonal affect disorder. You are just receiving the vibes of our country.
When did this turn into the
and
Art Bell
New
show?
Year.
That's, I'm just telling you that we are a very sick country.
Art Bell, ladies and gentlemen.
We are. And so if you're not feeling well, if you're depressed and sad, it's not you. It's our country. Liam McEnany, yes. January 10th, will be at the Bell House.
2016.
There'll be a live taping of your new album.
It'll be, and I'm very excited. I've been road testing this material, which is something I didn't do for my last album, mm-hmm. which, by the way, my last album was pretty great, and I highly recommend picking that up through David's Amazon link. If you go to whatever this website is, and you click on the Amazon store, pick up Liam McEnany, comedian.
Yeah.
David gets about 43 cents.
Yeah.
Oh, wow, great.
So come see Liam McEnany at the Bell House January 10th, taping his album. Come for Colin Jost and Dave Hill. Try to stay for Liam
if you can. Yeah, if you got the kids at home,
but
go.
Honest to God, I just want your money. So if you have to leave, but if you go to heyitsliam.com for more info, or you can go to buy tickets at tinyurl.com/cliam, and that'll take you right to the ticket link.
And how do you spell McEnany?
MC capital ENEANEY.
Do that again.
MC capital ENEANEY.
Samantha Ruddy, what is your Twitter handle?
It is Samly Matters. SAMLY Matters.
And you will be at the Creek in the Cave January 5th at 10 p.m. with comedian Mark Norman.
Yes.
And where is the
Who's
Creek?
Been on this podcast.
Yes, he has.
He's very funny, John.
So funny. It is in Long Island City, right off the 7 train, first stop.
First stop off
in the
7.
In the Queens, yeah.
In the Queens. Well, thank you all for listening from the Showbiz Studios in downtown Manhattan. That'll do it for us.
The David Feldman radio program is made possible by listeners like you. You sad, pathetic humps. Thank you.